30 years ago, 10,950 days ago, there was a great moment in the history of global healthcare, and that was the start of the Apollo hospitals. It was a dream come true for our chairman. It was a dream which has today touched over 20 million lives. It was a dream which 75,000 workforce diligently adhere to day in and day out. And that's really what the Apollo story has been. I'd like to welcome all of you esteemed members of the press who've been our friends for over the journey of 30 years, clinicians who've taken some time off to come and join us at this press conference. I'd really like to welcome you, not on behalf of just me, but on behalf of the entire Apollo Hospitals family. I'm so glad that we have our chairman who really started this journey off for us, and our joint managing director, who's actually, she's been responsible for the Apollo name itself, so she's the one who even christened Apollo Hospitals as what it is. So I'd like to introduce my colleague, my sister, and our joint managing director, Sunita, also for this event. Before we start talking to each other, I'd like to play just a small audiovisual which really echoes the sentiments which all of us have and how we work together with the patients, making a difference in their lives.
Hi, I'm Dr. Priya, and this is a little miracle baby who was born yesterday. Apollo made me feel very happy to have this baby. What I really like about Apollo is the doctors, everybody tells us what happens, does not keep us in the lurch, informs us, keeps us making feel very comfortable. Even the latest treatments, that's one thing that I really chose Apollo for.
Hi, I'm Sashikala. Apollo doesn't feel like an hospital for me. Vasha is born here. Very friendly atmosphere in this hospital. And I always feel very safe and secure in this hospital. Apollo have very good doctors here. They are very expert in their field. They take care of us to whatever extent they can. Congratulations, Apollo, for your 30th anniversary. I wish you will continue the same in future also. I think you are doing your best now.
Apollo under dengue fever, I have a very severe attack. I have been hospitalized. I have been in hospital. I have been sick for months. All my friends and relatives, all of them, said that Apollo is not going to be able to take me. I am in the car. I am not. All the people are coming. 5% of the hope that we have on the stage. இங்கே வந்ததுக்கப்புறம் சொன்னதெல்லாம் எவ்வளோ உண்மைன்றது எங்களுக்கு ட்ரூவாக பார்த்துட்டோம். டீம் ஆஃப் டாக்டர்ஸ் வந்து ரொம்ப நல்லபடியாக கவனிச்சிக்கிட்டாங்க. எவ்வளோ எந்த அளவுக்கு நாங்கள் பயந்தோமோ அதை விட அவங்களோட எஃபர்ட்டு, சின்சியர் எஃபர்ட்டு, எங்களால் ப்ரேயர்ஸ் தான் பண்ண முடிஞ்சது. பட் எந்த டாக்டர்ஸ் பண்ணுறது எங்களுக்கு கடவுள் தான் வந்து என் குழந்தைய திரும்பவே கொடுத்துட்டாங்க. எனக்கு தேங்க்ஸ்ன்ற வார்த்தை வந்து ரொம்ப சின்ன வார்த்தை, பட் அதை ஃபீல் பண்ணி சொல்லணும்னா அதுக்கு வார்த்தையே கிடையாது.
I came from Nigeria exactly 2 months ago. I came here for treatment. I have sickle cell anemia and I've been unable to work for 3 years now. So I'm very, very impressed with the doctors and the nurses. So now I'm feeling better. When I was back home, I can't even stretch my leg this way. But now I can do that. And I can even manage to walk a little with help. So I'm very, very impressed, and may God bless Apollo Hospital. And as they're about to celebrate their 30th anniversary.
Hi, I am Salim. I'm coming from Oman, and I'm doing surgery here. Just like one thing, Apollo is in my family. He's not the hospital. Because if patient is coming here, he's comfortable. 100% is comfortable. The Apollo is fine for you, for the patient. Housekeeping good and nurses is good. I am here in the hospital 1.5 years. I'm not feeling for my family.
நான் இங்கே அப்போலோவில் வந்து ஜென்ரல் சர்ஜரிக்காக ஒரு அட்மிட் ஆகியிருக்கேன். எனக்கு சர்ஜரி நல்லபடியாக முடிஞ்சது. அப்போலோவில் இருக்கிற டாக்டர்ஸ் எல்லாமே ஒரு நல்ல டாக்டர்ஸ், நல்ல எக்ஸலண்ட் டாக்டர், நல்ல கோஆப்ரேட்டிவ், நல்ல கோர்டேஷன் டாக்டர்ஸ். இங்கே அப்போலோ வந்து எனக்கு நல்ல நர்சிங்காக இருக்கிறது, நல்ல ஹவுஸ் கீப்பிங் அனுபவத்தை கொடுத்து, நல்ல ஃபுட்டு அரேஞ்ச் பண்ணி கொடுத்தாங்க. நான் இங்கே ரொம்ப சந்தோஷமாக இருக்கேன். இப்போது அப்போலோ வந்து 30 வருஷத்தை கொண்டாட போகிறத கேள்விப்பட்டேன். இன்னும் மென்மேலும் நல்ல மருத்துவ வசதியை எல்லா உலகத்தில் இருந்த அத்தனை மக்களுக்கு அளிக்குமாறு என்னுடைய வார்த்தைகளை தெரிவிக்கிறேன்.
ஷீ இஸ் மை வைஃப் எம் சாந்தா. Yeah, I was a person always available to go to Apollo whenever I was sick or for any concert. Yes, I saw people about Apollo in many people. They all come here and we are very happy. This hospital is celebrating 30th year that has saved so many people from near death. And we come here as sick people who are strong people because there are very fine doctors. Very good administration. Nurses are very much dedicated, very much satisfied with all people.
Congratulations, Apollo, for your wonderful 30 years.
Wishing many more success to Apollo.
Thank you, Apollo.
Thank you, Apollo Hospital.
I like Apollo Hospital.
Congratulations. Thank you, Apollo.
Thanks to Apollo.
Thank you, Apollo.
Thank you, Apollo.
Ordinary people from different walks of life who put their trust in us, and I think that is really what is so important about being part of this Apollo family. It's not about numbers, it's actually not even about announcements today, it's just about rededicating ourselves to this mission. You know, we could have had 10 Americans who come to us and who trust us on this videotape. But you know, those are people who trust us and come from overseas. But it's the Indians who really have made a difference, who've shown us that we can, you know, become a global healthcare player. And who have, the person who has really made this vision possible, who's been doing this with missionary zeal, is our chairman. And I'd like to invite him to share what the whole story was all about and what he thinks the future holds, not only for Indian healthcare, but for global healthcare at large. And I'd like to invite our chairman to share his thoughts with you in the next few minutes.
I think it's very wonderful to recollect the scene that happened a day before. Then, like today, 17th September 1983, when the press met at the third floor of Apollo Hospital, and that floor was still not finished. So they said, Dr. Reddy, I don't know, first time we were walking into a building which we don't believe is a hospital. It is true. It is not a hospital. It was not then a hospital, even today it's not a hospital. It was a building which is built to fulfill the hope of people. The hope of people in this case was, in 1989, I lost a young man, a 38-year-old, who was to have had his surgery at Houston for his bypass, for his heart surgery in Houston. And I lost him in December because he couldn't raise. You know why he lost his wife? Because he couldn't raise $50,000 to go to Houston. Seeing his young wife, 31-year-old wife, and four-year-old daughter, two-year-old son, I thought to myself, how many more of our people are going to lose their beloved ones? How much of our country is going to suffer because we are going to lose the people who are productive in their ages? That was the origin of our power. That to bring that healing available for our people, it was not easy, because the regulations then did not permit a hospital to be registered as a company. Regulations never allowed Apollo hospitals to take a loan from the banks, and the equipment that was used to diagnose and treat people was treated as a luxury item, and at about 370% duty. All of these, you know, when I formulated to myself saying that we need to do this, first we need to get again in. Rita explained beautifully how Sunita came forward and said, oh, Daddy, You are looking for a name which would depict medicine, science, and hope. That's Apollo, the goddess. So I think we put that name. Then I again begin the story saying, how do we get all of these cleared by the various agencies? And so my describing each one of these, I only say in one word, if Apollo Chennai had got a million bricks, I had a million problems. You know, that was in Delhi, that was in then Madras. Everything was new to them. You know, even if I convince a minister or secretary, the under secretary or the head clerk would say, I don't understand this. So that was the story, but I'm happy that I think the focus and the determination that me and the small team that were with me, band of team who were with me, we went ahead and the culmination of the inauguration on September 18, 1983 by the then president was very significant. I repeat the words of the president, Nani Zel Singh, he said, Bhav Bhaga Chahai, I am very, very, very pleased. Oh, Houston may I, you know, you had a surgery in Houston. Everybody started comparing the Houston may I or Houston may I. So score, I think, was we scored 60 and Houston scored 40 out of the several comments that he made. I think that was a very good start, very auspicious start to say, here is a person who has experienced a hospital of par excellence, you know, overseas, saying, this is yes, it has got everything that it can make a good hospital. Then I think came the big task of putting people together. You know, I have star surgeons even here, but it is not, you know, Apollo is not made by one person. It is what's called the team approach. That is where I think we built processes and the team. And from day one, our focus was very clear. We will not compromise. We will have to give them the very best possible outcome. And our simple thing was, we must live up to the trust of people who walked into the hospital. Why did that trust come? You are responsible, the media was responsible. Because I could not have talked to the whole country. I could not have talked to the whole world. But thanks to you, you started describing me in many ways. Sometimes in a good way, sometimes in a humorous way, that way the five-star hospital. And I know, I think you all remember, when you said five-star, please don't disqualify me. I'm a seven-star hospital. Because these are my seven-star qualities of excellence that this hospital exhibits. Soon enough, practically everybody across the country came in here. So much so I recurred to understand when Sri Rajiv Gandhi wanted to visit this hospital, the DGP Madras said, no, this is high security risk here. And he couldn't come. So I asked the DGP. DGP said, sir, inge paathalum inge, you know, your Sardarjis are here. Today we had only one Sardarji. That was my security. And he also has left. But I think this is really clearly shows that people across the country trusted Apollo. And I think we went on to say, how do we continuously improve this trust? The story all began with coronary artery disease, the CABD. And in that room when we decided saying, what should we charge? If it's going to cost $50,000 in US to do the same level of surgery or to do better than that, what should we charge? We charged then $3,000. After 30 years, what do you think is the cost of CABG surgery at Apollo? With inflation at the rate of 6 to 15%, it should be perhaps something like $60,000. But Apollo today charges for an ordinary patient $2,000 for a coronary bypass surgery. That's, you know why? That's because we continually started improving our services and continuously did innovations. Please remember, why I'm mentioning this continuous improvement innovation is, this is our promise on 30th year, that we'll innovate, we'll continuously improve what we have been doing. The innovation that we did then was, you know, the team of Girinath started doing beating heart surgeries. And the infectious diseases team said, we are wasting antibiotics, and that antibiotics is further increasing the morbidity of patients. We give them one shot of antibiotic half an hour before. So like that, we did several. We decreased the morbidity, we increased his well-being, and certainly the cost came down significantly. And this is how we could continuously improve in every single discipline of medicine and surgery, the continuous improvement. And today, our promise at the end of 30 years, having achieved anything that any hospital anywhere in the world does, you can say there are four hospitals which are continuously racing to be number one in the world: Mass General, Cleveland Clinic, Mayo Clinic, and Johns Hopkins. They are among the top four in the US. And for the US, US is the world. So if they are first in the US, they are supposed to be the first in the world. Now let me tell you, in several of these, we match or outmatch the outcomes that these hospitals have. Now talking about coronary artery disease, Cleveland Clinic is supposed to be the center for coronary artery disease. I assure you, the outcomes that Apollo gives is as good or even better in many ways. But what they don't give, what we give, is the compassion and care. What our MT continuously saying, the TLC. So I think in every aspect, we have benchmarked ourselves against the best centers in the world. In oncology surgeries, we match with MD Anderson and Sloan Kettering in medical and surgical oncology. And today we do everything that they do. And very soon you are going to see that we are going to set up a separate department of minimal oncology robotic surgery unit. You know why? Oncology surgery means for patients, they think it's dreadful. So this is why we are bringing the best possible technology and then making it minimally invasive with robotic surgery, which is going to further continuously improve the level of comfort. The outcomes are going to be outstanding, and we are creating a separate department of minimal robotic oncology surgery for the benefit of patients. Like this I can go on. The number of things we did in the last 30 years benchmarked ourselves in every single discipline, and then this is what it was. The team was ready to bring in a solution and then implement it and then say, here we are. We can do everything that, and I think you all know, 2013 has been a memorable year for us because we became world number one in solid organ transplant, in kidney, heart, and liver transplant. But I think I owe it some, to a large extent, to some of you who are sitting here, or all of you who are sitting here. We could have not reached these numbers if we did not propagate the cadaver transplant. It's you who told people at the times of distress, saying, if the doctors say that the patient is brain dead, after completely, satisfying themselves by doing a flat EEG, and repeating that EEG after 6 hours, that means the patient is dead. Because for him, we are maintaining him artificially by giving medicines for his heart, and the lungs are pumping because of the ventilator. So for him, this patient is still alive. But for medically, it's a flat EEG, that means his brain dead. At that time, if they give consent, we can use their kidneys, their liver, their heart, their eyes, and also pancreas, and I think there are so many more organs that we can continuously use. And for that, I think Tamil Nadu requires a big, big thank you from, not just from Apollo Hospital, sir. I think this is from the number of patients. And I'm very happy some other states now are trying to bring this definition of brain dead and the doctor's certification. So we hope the media there also will follow your example, so that the people across the country could make a significant difference. I don't have to tell the long list of people who are waiting with chronic end-stage failures, from the kidney, from the heart, from the liver, and so on and so forth. There are so many diseases from which they are waiting, and their only hope is the medicines have failed. Surgery is no cure for them, The only cure for them is to have an organ replacement. For them, it is very important that we promote cadaver transplant program. Like many things that have been pioneered in the country by Apollo, let me tell you, even the cadaver transplant program was pioneered personally by our team in Chennai when we brought this legislation from Minneapolis Heart Institute and convinced the government of India. And do you know at what time it was passed? When the parliament was called to impeach Seshan, I went to the parliament. V.C. Sukla was the parliamentary affairs minister, I'm sorry, yeah, the late V.C. Sukla. He said, Dr. Reddy, we called for the session, the impeach session. Unfortunately, we don't have a majority. I said, if you don't have a majority, why don't you pass this legislation? Since you've already called the parliament, come, let's go to the Prime Minister. Prime Minister was P.V. Narasimha Rao. He told me, yes, yes, I promised Dr. Reddy, let's go ahead and implement the Organ Transplant Act. That's how the Organ Transplant Act of India, Government of India, was passed. But unfortunately, there were not many teeth that were left in it to use it to convince patients to get this. I think Tamil Nadu government requires the support. Sheila Priya, I think, played a very significant difference. Now the doctors can certify the moment the EEG is flat. So I think Tamil Nadu and Apollo Hospitals deserves that pioneering that one of those many efforts that we have done. I think what really important is, I can go on of the many things that Apollo has done, and you all know it, day after day, several times you have cooperated whenever you have done newer technology or brought in new things to make a difference in people's lives. But what's most important is, you're going to ask me, Dr. Reddy, what are you going to do this year? The most important thing that we want to do is to make people aware that it's their business to look after their health. I've asked this before. None of you answered this question before. Do you know the cost of your body? Everybody told me priceless, priceless, priceless. But for everything there is a price. Even this has got a price. I can't say this is good, this is useless. This body has a price. Previously it was costed as $6 trillion by a study done in Nashville. Recently in New Haven, they said it cost $1,000 trillion because what they have done is they have taken each part of our body and priced individually. There are several trillions of neurons in the brain. Even if they put saying it costs say 1.25 pence and it costs an X amount. So like that they went on. So our body costs so many trillions of dollars and it doesn't make a difference between you and your neighbor. Probably the difference is probably $2,000. Maybe a few dollars or maybe $2,000. Even if it's $1 trillion, still you are a very expensive person. So don't you think it's our duty to take responsibility for our health? This is what Apollo is going to do. We all take together saying, we'll work to heal India and we'll work to give lessons to heal the world. Thank you.
It was not easy. Every day literally has witnessed many revolutions take place which have impacted the healthcare landscape of the world. Introducing clinical excellence and clinical outcomes into the healthcare lexicon was not easy when we started. But today, India can boast of fantastic clinical outcomes within the whole healthcare landscape. Quality accreditation with JCI and NABH. Again, Apollo took on the challenge and did it for the first time. Centers of excellence. Emergency care and a dedicated number 1066. From that was spun off 108. So we have a robust emergency system within the country. Primary health care as family clinics in the neighborhood. And now we're talking about personalized health checks. The assurance of genuine medicines with branded pharmacies. We can say very, very clearly that not one day has any spurious drug been traded in any one of our pharmacies. Telemedicine and technology in healthcare. And then we have telemedicine and technology in healthcare. every day in India there is a telemedicine consult. There are about, I'm sorry, there are 500 telemedicine consults happening within the Indian landscape. Encouraging medical value travelers, you saw that, and it's happening every day that travelers coming. But there's so much more to be done in that space. Health education, clinical research, sorry.
Travel. It was very close to our hearts. This is not today. I coined this word that India will become the healthcare destination for the world 10 years ago. The moment we evaluated that outcomes of medical and surgical outcomes in India, not just in Apollo, in majority of the hospitals are amongst the best. Then India also had the other systems of medicine for which people deservedly were coming into India. And the story was just picking up. But unfortunately, 4 years ago or 5 years ago, the government of India wisely, without talking to the actual payers, suddenly brought a draconic law that medical tourists had to pay 3 times visa fees. It will take three days to get a visa. And then when they arrive here, they'll have to go and report to the FCR or the police. And that police guy happily sits with a cigarette in his mouth and says, you know, the other day, a senior official from one of these countries came to me. He said, Dr. Reddy, 90% of my people from our country would don't want to come here because, first, you know, to get that visa. Second, the moment they are told that they have to go and report to the police, and what they hear from their colleagues, that brings them hatred. So I think it's a you know, I used to tell the government of India, the way the people from overseas are coming and then going back so happy, not only the treatment and the care that they get, I said we'll get a seat in the permanent seat in the Security Council. Today, we lost, I think, even in General Assembly. So I think this is a horrible draconian law. None of you have challenged it. I have talked everywhere, what's the use? I can only talk to this hall. But you have got the power of your pen. The media can take this saying. Why have they done this? If it is only for security purposes, I have challenged them saying, if a patient comes to any of our hospitals, we can give 24 hours connectivity if you want. If it is for security, it's the real reason. But nobody has answered. I met a Minister for External Affairs, Minister for Home. They're tossing it between the two. But I want this, if this is answered, please believe me, you have heard of a hospital called Bumrungrad in Thailand. That hospital where rupee had depreciated in the 90s, that's the time it boomed. It had only 11 patients before. Today, it receives the world's largest number of medical tourists. But you know what they do? They don't do even 1/10 of the advanced things that we do. But still people go there, because if you go to the Bangkok airport, there are several hundreds of people enjoying their tea, waiting, you know, they're getting their visas cleared, get into the bus and happily go to the hospital. Then Singapore took it up, saying it's a great thing and promoted Singapore medicine, spending millions of dollars. Then Malaysia did this. What did we do? When those three countries promoted their medical tourism, we put a chopper on that. What a shame this is. I don't know why the discussions took place, whether they come with this reason, no one questioned. But you all question if something happens in some one hospital or one doctor does. And that doctor, I must say here again, my lady doctor gets up at 3:30 in the morning to do a delivery, you know, taking all that personal risk. At 4 o'clock, if there is a major accident, my surgeons, my neurosurgeons, all of them arrive in the hospital, the radiologists, the technologists, all of them arrive. Tell me of whatever profession which does this. Don't you think that they deserve some amount of credibility? I think it's a shame. You know, I'm talking just now to Hyderabad, one of the senior delegation from another country came. He said, Dr. Reddy, my country would love to send 10 times more people to you, because when we send them to other countries, first, we spend, you know, 10 times more on the medical expense, but then surgery is not done and the patient dies there, staying 2-3 years. So our expats enemies come to $1 million. So they would love to send it here. They use the word, would love to send here. But our people hate this business, saying, why should we go and report? You know, a man with a self-respect. I know of a very, very prominent lady in Kuwait. She said, I must get treated only in Chennai, Apollo. I have multiple problems. There's the only hospital who will address all my problems. Because when I go to the US, then that guy picks up this one problem and then say, this is what I would like to do for you. I go to another one, it does. But the visa is refused. You know why? Her passport says she has visited Pakistan several times. You know, these are the things that I think we need to seriously question ourselves. Why are we stopping the country back? Why now when we are struggling for dollar, this one? You know what the medical tourism in this part of the world is? Indonesia alone spent $11 billion. Other parts of Southeast Asia spends $4 billion. Africa spends $10 billion. Middle East spends $30 billion plus. So it's $70-80 billion plus. Rightfully, I think India should get majority of this, at least 51% of that. But more than that money that we are talking about, this is the only profession I say. You know, you have talked about saying India provided in the last 5 or 7 years 16 lakh additional employments. What happened now in the last 3 months? If they have not lost, they are going to lose that additional 16 lakh employment. But healthcare is the only one which will give millions and millions and millions of additional jobs. And this will be another feather in India's cap. So please take up this issue with the government and come to let them understand. Let them say this is the right time to get this film. They don't have to spend millions of dollars as the rest of the countries have done, because the world knows that Indian doctors, Indian healthcare today is par excellence and cost benefit.
Thank you, Chairman. I think that was a very passionate appeal to make a difference, and that's really what Apollo's always been about. It's about making a difference, it's about innovating, having strategies which will impact superior patient care. And I'm so glad that Sunita is here with us, because she's been responsible for so much of the good stuff which is happening at Apollo, and I want her to share her thoughts with us at the podium or here, wherever you're comfortable.
Namaste, ladies and gentlemen, members of the press, the Apollo family. It's very rarely that I actually like to come out and speak, because I feel that the work that we do speaks for us far more than we actually getting up on stage, and especially getting up on stage and making a speech. But I just have six small short points that I'm going to make today, because I think Chairman and Vita, they've actually covered quite a bit. But before I start, Kritika, can I have you put that 20-year slide with all the different languages in place? I'd rather look at that than my face. So, just to tell you, you know, like Coke has a secret formula, which they believe is a secret to success. I believe that many years ago in 1970, when Chairman came back, he actually discovered that secret formula. But no formula can be successful unless it gives value to the patient. It creates something that the society requires very badly. And I think this is what Apollo did. It came at a time when there was no good healthcare in India, and it provided something of value to each patient. The secret that really took us forward is the ability to scale this, you know, from the single hospital that we started in Chennai 30 years ago, which we're celebrating today, was the ability to scale this and take it on an all India basis. And how we did that is really the stuff that Chairman Pita and history and health history is made of. What we really did was to balance the interests of all the stakeholders. By stakeholders, I mean the investors, people who became part of the Apollo story, our doctors, the management, and most important of all, our patients. As you know, investors want returns on their stock, they want liquidity, and they want safety. It's actually, when you think about it, it's the same with the patient. They want to see that they return to a healthy life. They want to see that they're in a safe environment, and they want to see that while they're in that environment, that they're looked after carefully. So, you know, I think we were able to achieve that balance. The second part of that balance is was to marry the business model with the clinical model. And that, I think that it's not only just four sisters and chairman working together. We had such a good professional team that helped us do it. There were doctors and there were management people who really worked together to create a really robust business model as well as a clinical model. And it couldn't, you know, you can't do it independently. They have to exist together. And together, we built a value for money proposition, which meant that patients were coming in here and they were going back with good clinical outcomes, and they were able to lead a healthy life. And I think that's why they showed you those testimonials. It's proof that the business model succeeded, but more importantly, it's proof that the clinical model was a huge success. And for that, I'd really like to thank all of our doctors today who were part of this. Many of you will think, you know, what is Apollo strategy all about? And I've been asked this many times. It's clearly to build the quaternary care in Tier 1 hospitals, where we managed to attract the best doctors from around the world, as well as foreign patients, like Chairman said. But it's also to move out into Tier 2 cities and create the type of healthcare that people desperately need. You know that Tier 2 cities contribute to 30% of the GDP. Well, we believe that from this, you know, 40 to 50% of our revenues will start coming from Tier 2 cities. And the growth, and I think Apollo has a first mover advantage in being able to capture this growth. So clearly it's to create clusters in Tier 1 cities that will look after patients, to look at preventive health care, and then to move into Tier 2 cities, which we've already begun. As you know, our expansion plan is to create over the next 36 months to create another 2,400 beds, which is really 25% of our capacity. So you can be assured that you will see good top line growth coming from Apollo in the next 3 years. I think at this time I would like to thank all our directors who were part of helping us, who were guiding us through these years. You know, nothing was very difficult for us, I have to admit, because we really loved doing what we do. As human beings, as professionals, I think we were deeply committed to Apollo. Our heart continues to beat for Apollo every day. And today when we think of 30 years, you know, and they said, come, let's do a campaign. I said, what is this? We're not 30 years old. I don't feel old at all. We're actually 30 years young. And 30 years in the life of a person, you know, it's you've got the experience behind you, but you've also got the energy to implement innovation. And I think that's what the next 30 years is going to be about. And I'm not going to really talk about the number of beds, because please don't define Apollo by the number of beds we have. As we grow, you know, it is clearly about asset utilization. It's how we marry technology with clinical excellence. It's how we use our assets. And I think the introduction of robotics, etc., it's no longer going to be about the number of beds. It's going to be about the clinical excellence and the revenues that we can drive with the capacity that we have created. So don't ever let that fool you. So if someone says they have 30,000 beds, well, good for them. Even with 10,000 beds, we will get to revenues of 20, which a 20,000 bed person can have. I think, finally, I'd like to say that what helped to sustain us was clearly the focus on quality. And that is no compromise. It is an area that we will never compromise, whether it's quality in the work that we do in the hospital or in maintaining a healthy balance sheet. It's something that I'm truly proud of, that you know, that all of us are consistent in our thinking that this is fundamental to the way that we grow, that we maintain quality. I don't think, when we were thinking about this, I wrote a small note and I said, I don't think people around us know that 1,000 things these doctors and nurses have to think about before you go into an operating theater. But they do that, and they do that meticulously. I don't think you know of the thousands of gestures that they have to do post-operation to see that you are safe and away from infection. But this is the hallmark of Apollo, that we do this, and we do this meticulously, and we do it because it is in our DNA. It is clearly, you know, I think in these past 30 years, we have built a strong balance sheet. Our endeavor for the next 30 years is to build a strong India and to enhance and enrich the lives of every Indian. And this is truly our signature. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
To share his, and you know, he's done the largest number of CME programs, and one is going on downstairs, and we pulled him up to join us. So I'd like him to share his thoughts with us today.
Thank you, madam. Whenever I go and give a talk, including my Saturday talk in Ahmedabad, it's usually I start with, I bring greetings from our beloved chairman, Pratap C. Reddy. But here I can't do that one since our beloved chairman is here, and along with him I am thankful to our MD, Mrs. Pritha Reddy, and our JMD, Sunita Reddy, for asking me to come in front of you. And I also thank you all for coming and listening to what our success story is. See, it's very difficult to say anything after our chairman's speech, because I've been hearing our chairman's speeches from 1983 onwards. So how they have changed. Then afterwards, what has happened? I started hearing our MD speeches and our JMD speeches. Both are excellent. In fact, actually, there is no way you can I can say anything. So before I say what is my experience, what I noticed one thing in these 30 years is Apollo and our chairman, both names are synonymous. When I say Apollo, it is our chairman. When I say our chairman, it is Apollo. There is no difference. In this, when I came 30 years ago, ours was a small hospital and we were small people. But what the important thing was, our chairman chose a rather best faculty, and we had a very small family. We were all together, and now in these 30 years, the growth, what I could see, is enormous. Unbelievable, and I don't even feel that it's already 30 years is over. That when I came here, I was young, and even the front launch floor was not ready at that time. As far as the clinical excellence is concerned, our chairman spoke, and our MD spoke about expansion, and I cannot say anything about our JMD because I don't know much of financial things at all. But we have far exceeded in our clinical excellence. Our aim is to give excellent treatment as much as they need to the best what they can get anywhere in the world. But that part has been spoken. You all know, I don't think I need to tell. And our chairman is well ahead before any new equipment comes. As a surgeon, when I know, before that our chairman knows. And so by the time anybody thinks in the country that new equipment is here in our hospital. And our Chennai being the first flagship hospital of the group, we always talk about Apollo means Chennai. But of course for our chairman, Apollo means all over the country. And personally I feel the vision of our chairman, in fact in Ahmedabad when I was talking to some of the Delhi surgeons, they said, Dr. Reddy has changed the entire health scenario of Delhi. I said, it's not only Delhi, it's the whole country scenario has changed, and other countries are trying to follow us because we are getting a lot of foreign patients as well. They are trying to improve their own medical infrastructure as well. In addition to the clinical excellence, what is important, what is happening in Apollo Hospital is, all of you probably may not know, we do a lot of educational activities. We give a lot of importance because our chairman's vision is we achieve the clinical excellence, but next we have to do education and the research projects. These are very important as we at Apollo are concerned. So we have a lot of educational programs which are going on, which are recognized with national boards of examinations, Ministry of Health, and we do conduct a lot of educational activities in our hospital, and which are approved by the university, the MJR Medical University, and that is not for the sake of any financial reasons or anything. We impart the knowledge to others because we have achieved, we have got all the infrastructure. Others should learn from our hospital site. And this, how gradually you say, health sector is not an easy sector to run. Health sector is one of the most difficult sector to run because along with the health sector, the medical technology is increasing in a very rapid way. To keep up with the medical technology, I think we are one of the first people to catch up with it. And we have practically, as our MD and JMD have mentioned, we have practically, when we started our minimal access surgery, we thought that was the only thing. Now we have gone into subdivision called robotic surgery. That is another variety of minimally invasive surgery. From there we are going on to robotic oncology surgery, as our chairman mentioned. Like this, the medical technology, whatever we have, where we have started, where are we now, we are on par with any of the American hospitals presently. And a word about our chairman. I don't think in my life I can come across any other person like our chairman. You always, I remember, when we walk into his house, we come out happily, whether it was negative, whether it was positive, we could walk out of his office happily in a smiling face, not in a different way, that type of person. And the clinical knowledge, what I learned it from him, that is, it is unbelievable actually. As a physician, I learned a lot of surgical things from him actually. And I'm sure these, as I said actually, as I say, Apollo and our chairman, they go synonymous. That's why I'm talking about our chairman rather than Apollo, because you all heard more about Apollo from our chairman and MD and JMD.
30 years ago, those who joined, 3 years ago, those who joined yesterday, they're all one great team performing for excellence. We can probably.
Exciting chairman, but the way I look at it, and in the true Apollo spirit, to us the journey has just begun. You know, we've learned the art of building hospitals cost-effectively, providing cost-effective care to our citizens, trying different means of seeing how they can find access, both geographical and financial, by bringing insurance for the first time. But I think the journey is just beginning for us, because when we went back to chairman and said, okay, we're 30 years, and what do you want us to do? He said, find ways and means to keep India healthy. And I think that is why we're seeing a spate of preventive checkup programs. We took it on ourselves now to say that, you know, we're going to screen 30,000 citizens within our reach to see how can we predict the onset of disease, how can we keep them healthy, and then replicate this model to different states in India. So the different thoughts which are coming up, you know, when we turned 25 years, we said the Apollo Reach Hospitals is what we will do. We will take the Apollo hospitals to tier 2 cities. We have 10 of them functional now. Now we're trying to see how can we take preventive care to a different level, and I think that is what the 30-year agenda is going to be, so that, you know, when we come up with something new, exciting and productive, people to ask me about competition. I think the world is changing. It's all about collaboration now. And if we can set the first step and do something phenomenal which will impact healthcare for our country and everybody follows suit, I think that's probably the best thing which can happen in India. So thank you all for supporting us in this journey of 30 years, and I know that you will be our partners for the next 30 years to come. Stay well, stay healthy, because it's our responsibility to keep our country healthy. Thank you all for being part of this. We're open for questions and answers now.
Dr. Reddy, haven't you thought that you missed a global journey? You are in Sri Lanka, you missed the opportunity. You are in, but trying to be in London, UK, you missed the opportunity. You are in Singapore, you missed the opportunity. You are in Hong Kong, also missed the opportunity. Maybe you are bidding for something which you couldn't succeed at. 30 years too late, at least you could have had some sort of your foothold in one of the overseas markets where you can serve the. Of course, very later we entered into African regions kind of thing. But some of the markets which were trying to get into, but which you couldn't succeed in. Haven't you thought that you missed the opportunity in those places?
I think that's a very good question. Everybody wants, you know. We are proud that Tata's did it, Birla's did it. So many others are doing, you know, spreading and their business overseas. But you know, there is so much of unfinished business in the country. This is our prime responsibility. But I am not shirking the responsibility to give. First, we are giving for patients there to come. But we have never told you the number of doctors and the medical teams who come to India, not for CMA programs alone, but who come for training with us. And we are doing this continuously for at least for the last one decade. Today, the telemedicine program, we have at least, you know, 50, 60 countries have got the telemedicine connectivity with Apollo, where we not only give medical advice to them, we also run the CMA program for them. Physically, for us to transplant and then put hospitals there, yes, one day will come. But I think, as I said, we are facing a huge challenge in the country. We need to build 100,000 beds per year for next 10 years. And in that portion, as you know, we have always limited ourselves, saying Apollo will do the tertiary and quaternary care hospitals. That's about 9% of this 100,000. So we need to add that 9,000 beds per year. We are striving to do that. We are now doing 1,000 beds. We probably will step up to 1,500 or 2,000 beds in the years to come. So, but definitely it's not our, you know, I am not against. I love to be there because I'll get more money, you know. But what it is, I think, since we started with a vision saying that we will bring international level of care for all cross-section of our people. That means we'll bring the quality, we'll bring the cost-benefit for our people. I think what we have not talked about is the philanthropy. You know, we have done the largest number, we never talk about, we've done the largest number of heart surgeries for poor children. More than 3,000. This year we committed we will do 1,000 this year alone for poor children, free heart surgeries. But this is not only Apollo's contribution. There are benefits in somebody's birthday, he donates 50,000 rupees, which will go towards materials. And Apollo doctors don't charge, Apollo hospitals don't charge anything. So we are doing this program. We have done the largest number of ear transplants for poor children. And I'm glad the Hyderabad team, which has done the maximum, has won the international conference. You know, there was a competition in Bangkok against Beijing and against US. They won the thing, and the conference is going to be held in Hyderabad. So I think we do that. We do a lot for cancer patients. But what we do more is what Preeta said, the screening programs. So we'll continue to do that to see how do we identify, how do we guide people. So I think that's one other aspect apart from, I took up a little more than what you said, you know, apart from saying, why aren't you abroad and make more money.
I think Chairman came back from the US to do something for India. That was his first agenda. Now that that agenda is fulfilled in a way that we have ventured abroad. Through our consulting division, we are working on many projects overseas. I think when the time is right, and more importantly, when we start understanding the environment like we did in Sri Lanka, we'll be in a better position to answer that question. But rest assured that it will not only have a clinical impact, but it will have a good business impact when we move in that direction.
Mr. You said that like you should, one should not judge you in terms of the numbers, in terms of the beds, but you should look at in a different perspective. Can you just like put more elaborate? Is it because of the module you are looking at it? For example, you gave an example saying that how clinical will be expanded and then it will be, it's more upper scope model you're talking about. Can you just like reform?
Yeah, I think that the way healthcare is changing, and I think Chairman is actually more qualified to answer that than so is Preeta, but I'll try. It's the way that healthcare is changing is that technology is bringing about better outcomes with shorter stays. So when we started in Apollo, our average length of stay was 9 days. Today it's 4 days. So you can imagine that in 4 days we would get typically the revenue that you would get in 11 days. So right now it's because of the quality of technology, the quality of rehab, the quality of aftercare, and the fact that now we're also moving into the home to look after the patient, that the beds don't really matter. It's the use of our assets, how well we use our assets, whether it's screening to give you a good opinion, a good diagnosis, whether it's theater utilization, whether it's utilization of the beds post and utilization of our people afterwards. I think, you know, the whole connectivity has been handled really well, so it's changed the way you look at healthcare.
The process now and what is the local like maybe down there. Having said that, you are looking at 2400 beds next 3 years. What will the size is every the bed will come from rural cities or tri-two cities or maybe the
1300 beds, 1200 beds are actually in the tier one cities where we have this, we have a cluster approach. So we have set up hospitals. For example, in Bombay, we've set up in Jayanagar and we're setting up another one. So it is to do a community, to do the community hospitals and a quaternary care hospital in tier one city. So we'll cover the whole city. And then to move into tier two cities. So it's 1,200 beds, which we consider in a way a brownfield because we're very well established in these cities. And then it's moving into tier two. So 1,300 of those beds are in tier one and the balance are in tier two cities.
Tier two cities and rural areas, there will be quite an impact on your financials. So you might have to be cost effective, and I've heard that the strategy is to be a cookie cutter model. So your expansion would be wide, at the same time it wouldn't be capital intensive. So can you please elaborate on that and how you plan to achieve this?
Yeah, I think, ours is a very balanced growth strategy where we invest more per bed in the city, and it's actually half the cost when we move to tier two cities. So we balance our return on capital employed. Our benchmark return on capital employed is we should in the next 5 years touch close to 19-20%. Currently it's trending at around 14%. But clearly, you know, the tier two cities present an opportunity where there's a faster return on capital employed because their break-even is much faster and they reach a positive EBITDA within 18 months. So it's a calibrated strategy where you're growing in tier one, which is capex heavy, and you're growing in tier two, which is a capex light.
You said 40-50% is the tier 2 revenue contribution currently.
No, I said it will be. I said it will be when we finish the expansion. It could. I said 30% of GDP is actually coming from tier 2. And it's in line with the Apollo strategy. So that by 2016, 30% of our revenues and definitely our profits will come from tier 2 cities. Currently, I'm sorry, I don't have that figure currently.
Question, final question for our chairman. Chairman, as an Indian and as a doctor, what is your vision for, you know, our country's healthcare? Because I think you're always setting the vision, you're always setting the leadership and the trend. So maybe if we can pick those thoughts up from you, we can carry on and do much more. And, you know, you can keep us running the way you've done all these 30 years.
Rita, you always have the last word. So I think it's nice for all of us to realize health does not just affect individuals' health. It affects the national economy. It severely affects the growth of a country. So I think this has to become a top priority. As an Indian, I would say that the health should get this overall recognition, and then we need to frame policies and thought processes to bring, how can we make India healthy? That's the most important wish I would want as an Indian. Not because Apollo has done all of these, but I told you the burden of NCDs, if that's going to be that severe, as an Indian I would like to see how do we overall ramp the whole thing and make India healthy.
Thank you all. True of Apollo Hospitality, we'd like you all to join us.